Now, whether or not that actually happened in Regensburg is neither here nor there. The fact is it caused a tremendous stir all over Europe, because the mysterious force holding those hemispheres together is what Gilbert had been theorising about in 1600 and what in 1654 had only just been discovered, the vacuum. Put inside those hemispheres by the newly invented vacuum pump invented by Otto Guericke, or rather adapted by Otto Guericke, because what he did was adapted one of these. You know what that is? It's what you have to have handy if most of your buildings are made of wood. It's a fire extinguisher. See? And Guericke adapted it to suck air instead of water. And it was a very big hit with him. Ferdinand III, Holy Roman Emperor. Ferdinand had taken the opportunity of his son's coronation to invite all the princes and bishops and barons and city representatives from all over Germany to come here to this Reichstag Hall for several months of discussions on things like taxation and war and economic policy. Now, they all sat in these benches, and Ferdinand, of course, being emperor, sat up there on his throne. Anyway, towards the end of the sessions in 1654, Ferdinand asked Otto Guericke, who was here because he was mayor of Magdeburg, if he, Guericke, would do some of the tricks that the emperor had heard he could do. And Guericke, in this hall, obligingly used his vacuum pump to make vacuums in glass spheres. And then he amazed the assembled company by showing them that mice suffocated in the vacuum, candles went out in it, if you rang a bell in it, you couldn't hear the bell, and all sorts of other goodies. Ferdinand was so tickled by the whole thing that when it was over, he asked if he could have all the apparatus. And being emperor, of course, he got it. Still, he did have the whole thing written up, which is how the rest of Europe got to hear about the vacuum pump. Guericke was a real dabbler. And he got very intrigued by one other thing he read in Gilbert's book, the bit about some substances like sulfur attracting things. So Guericke quite solemnly built himself this rather silly sulfur ball on a stick. And he spun it, and when he was spinning it, he rubbed it with his hand, like this. Now, the reason he did that is because he was looking for evidence of what we today would call gravity, why things stuck to the earth and didn't fly off into space. So when he wrote this experiment up, he went into great detail about things like the ball would attract a piece of thread, and when the thread was in contact with the ball, the thread would attract things. Fortunately, he also mentioned something else about which he entirely missed the point. He said, if you spin the ball and rub it, and then take it out and hold it next to your ear, you hear a crack. And if you do it in the dark, the ball glows. Now, I said that was fortunate that he mentioned it, because his half-interested comments kicked off investigation into why the crack and the glow occurred. And that turned out to be electricity. You know, the fascinating thing about moments like this in history is that they lead to so many places at once. We could, for instance, go forward from the vacuum pump to the investigation of air, to the discovery of oxygen, to finding out how the human lungs work, to modern respiratory medicine. Or we could go vacuum pump, steam engine, locomotive. Or we could go vacuum pump, investigation of gases, sending electric sparks through them to see what would happen, the cathode ray tube, modern radar. Or take the globe, the sulfur globe. The fact that the thread, when it was attached, you remember, carried the mysterious force away down the thread, led to people trying to do that deliberately, to send the force down wire. That in turn led to the telegraph, and that in turn led to the telephone. But for our purposes, let's take the route that leads to one of modern society's most horrifying inventions. And the next step on that route, from this 17th century government meeting forward into the future, takes us into the area of the Englishman's favourite topic of conversation, the weather. There was obviously some connection between Guericke's spark and lightning, so people got all excited about atmospheric electricity in general. Was there gunpowder in clouds? was Irish fog, more electric than other kinds. Interest centred on the unfortunate church bell ringers, who, now you mentioned it, did tend to get electrocuted with monotonous regularity, because one of their jobs was to ring the bell during storms. But lightning got taken really seriously only when they realised it was doing this little trick. Gunpowder stores kept on doing this. Now, this was serious. It wasn't just costing lives, it was costing money. It was these explosions that brought to public attention the ideas of the 15th son of an American soap maker, who flew his kite in a storm to prove his point. Franklin reckoned the key solution was lightning rods that would attract the negative electricity to their positive metal. Ship's masts were like lightning rods. And it was a disgruntled navy that finally got the subject widened to include storms in general, when this happened. In an attempt to warn their ships of storms, the Royal Navy started taking weather reports from them, as well as readings from their barometers. When the first of these collections was put together in 1861, they had the world's first weather chart of an Atlantic depression, looking remarkably modern. On land, the same thing started with stations reporting via the new telegraph. Now, fortunately, all this seriousness was tinged with some of the peculiar insanity of the period by the eagerness with which people now took to an amazing new invention, described just after it came out as infinitely the most extraordinary and magnificent discovery perhaps since creation. Now, you may feel that's a bit exaggerated, but you can understand why people got so very light-headed about it. It's one of the symptoms you suffer from when you use it. Going up in a balloon makes you feel like doing all sorts of daft things. By the middle of the 19th century, the balloon enjoyed the same kind of reputation the back seat of the motor car did in the 1940s. It was rather often used for purposes for which it had not been originally designed. I mean, Frenchmen in particular would cruise along with their girlfriends, dropping empty champagne bottles on the gaping peasants below, and returning to Earth to announce their engagement. Mind you, some of it was all serious science. They took up barometers and thermometers and cats and dogs and geese and ducks and sheep and 200-pound ladies to observe their effects on the weather, and vice versa. And these intrepid pioneers enjoyed all the privileges of going to high altitude without oxygen, bleeding at the ears and eyes, nausea, vomiting, swelling of the head, and passing out. Mind you, in spite of all that, they did learn things they never would have if they'd stayed on the ground, like the temperature does not decrease steadily as you rise in the sky, and nor does the air pressure. Some of them stayed up for days, drifting along, enjoying the view, dropping notes by parachute that never seemed to say much other than everything going remarkably well, including those who were never seen again. By the late 19th century, what with all these airborne anemometers and reports from shipping and stations on the ground using the new electric telegraph, you could pick up a copy of your Times in the morning and get almost as good a forecast as you can today. The only disadvantage to all this high-altitude information, which by now they regarded as vital, was that sooner or later, when you ran out of hot air or hydrogen or food or champagne, you had to come down. What they needed was some way of staying at high altitude for as long as they liked. Which is why our story next takes us to a place you'd imagine they would have thought of long before. A place where you can stay at high altitude for as long as you like. The Highlands of Scotland. Thank you. On October the 17th, 1883, this ancestral home at the bottom of a mountain was the venue for a get-together by the cream of enlightened Scottish gentility to mark the grand opening of a new weather station on top of the highest highland in the Highlands, Ben Nevis. Refreshments were offered to the guests, and provisions were loaded for the journey to come by numerous factors and gillies and other members of the unpronounceable Scottish lower orders.
Ladies and gentlemen, could we have you on the lawn for the commemorative photograph, please?
I think the commemorative photograph...
It was a grand, ludicrous, overdone affair, in the way that all philanthropic Victorian public occasions were. In any other country in the world, they'd have dropped the whole thing till the rain stopped. But this was 19th century Scotland, and they were bent on serious matters. So they gritted their teeth and cheerfully did their duty as the rain filled up their bagpipes. After all, was the whole thing not being recorded for posterity?
A little bit further in. Thank you. Hold it.
The really nice thing about what science did to the Victorians was that it made them all lunatic in the same way. So the townspeople of Fort William also did their duty as the procession passed, by getting soaked and waving silly flags as they were supposed to. At 9 a.m, the party began their trek up the mountain, led by a single piper busking a catchy little Celtic number called Lochiel's Awa de France. Why, I've never been able to find out. And the rain obligingly turned to sleet, so everybody could have what one was supposed to have when doing one's duty, a thoroughly rotten time. As more and more stations like Ben Nevis were set up and people could sit and look at the weather as it shifted and changed, they noticed that it made distinct patterns. So in good Victorian style, they catalogued them. And in the 1890s, came up with an official international cloud atlas, which gave clouds the names by which they're known today. And this catalogue of clouds is the next clue in our detective story, because clouds caused something strange to happen at Ben Nevis. You see, from the moment it opened, the station observers worked 24 hours a day. Each shift would send off regular reports on temperature, pressure, rain, and so on, and one of the reports they had to file would be about the clouds. And if you were on the dawn shift, you'd sometimes see the clouds in the valley do something very weird to your shadow. This is called a glory, and the strange thing about it is that the colours that appear in the halo don't appear in the order they do in the rainbow, but the other way round.